Good afternoon. We're so happy to have with us today, Kevin Malgrim from Midwest Vending and Repair. Kevin, welcome aboard, man.
Hey, it's honored to be here with you. And, you know, it's nice to be back in the room with a celebrity like yourself. Thanks for having me in. And really, I just do want to give a shout out to you, all the guys at Derosa. You guys are really what make lives like mine possible. And, you know, I really am indebted to you guys. I really appreciate everything you do.
No, absolutely, man. Hey, listen, we just like to bring the education. We like to bring knowledge. You know, one of the big models here at Derosa Group, transforming lives through real estate. You've done some real estate investing. Talk about specifically the real estate investing strategy that you have taken under in Denver and why Denver as a city has been very attractive, very receptive to your specific type of real estate investing.
One of the things that we use a lot, I also have a company called Plan for Life, and we work with a lot of people on how to become, we coach people that go from basically minimum wage all the way to becoming accredited investors where we are with net worths of over $1 million and being able to have some passive income. And one of the most powerful ways to do that, to get started, is to do a house hack. And what that is, to break it down for everybody, is to buy a house that's more house than what you need and be generous with that house by renting it out to other people and in turn paying your costs. And so even today, we still do that with our home. We rent out the entire basement to a longtime friend of mine, and we Airbnb a wing in the top floor of our house. And between the two, it more than pays our mortgage plus all of our other household expenses, maid service, water, energy, everything.
Right.
And it allows us to, you know, basically live in a nice house and have no cost in it. The biggest advantage to that is really the way prices have gone up in Denver, that you can leverage that to a high degree.
You make an interesting point. As expensive as single family homes have gotten in Denver, first of all, I get, what do you attribute that to?
We have averaged between 2,000 and 5,000 people a month migrating into Denver the last decade. Yeah. And Colorado itself has 7 of the 50 fastest growing MSAs in the United States. We have 3 of the top 10, Longmont, Denver, and Greeley, pre-COVID, were 3 of the top 10 fastest growing in the entire United States. Over the last 3 years, the population has really just exploded here. We have a lot of really unique things in Colorado that other places don't have. Our population has grown 24.16% since 2010. The housing is not keeping up with that. So, of course, once they legalized weed, that was a big driver here.
Yeah, shocker.
For a lot of different reasons. But this is one of the only recreational states that hasn't been priced completely out. You know, you can ski, bike, hike, all that kind of stuff here, and there's a lot to be had. We have more parks than anywhere else in the nation per capita and square land. And so it just drove a lot of people here. You can have a really good lifestyle here without having to get all crazy with yourself. There's a lot of companies here. We have a really diverse economy. So pre-COVID, we had one of the lowest unemployment rates in the entire nation. At one point below 2%. And the pay rate here, extremely high.
Yep.
And so it just drove a lot of people into Denver and into Colorado. It's a really phenomenal place to live.
Is it one area where a lot of these folks are gravitating towards, or are they pretty much dispersing themselves throughout?
There's some outside area of Denver that if you're looking for something a little bit more affordable, you pretty much have to exit the major Denver area. And that's not just Denver, but all the little surrounding, you know, areas to that. We're really exploding to the north, exploding to the south right now. Colorado Springs is and has been for a while one of the hottest markets in the United States, still continues to be. And that is really, I think that's an area there's still a long way to go. I think Denver still isn't done. So it's still a great place to come. A lot of people are coming into Denver. There's a wait list for houses. The actual average sale price for a home last month was over $630,000.
Wow.
That's up 17% from a year ago, and that's in the middle of COVID. Talking to a lot of people, they're also wondering here when's the crash going to be? right? So there's forbearance and all that stuff. And I can speak to that a little bit, that in December 2010, so back with the last crash, there was a total of 1,032 distressed homes that hit the market. And that represented about 30%, 36% of the closings. This last month, there was 11 distressed homes, 0.2%. Oh, wow. 5 were bank owned, 3 were short sales, and 2 were foreclosures. There's so many people here hungry for homes. There's so much equity in the homes. If you're looking to come and scoop up a bunch of foreclosures and all that, it's really not going to happen.
Right.
So the one other stat I'll throw at you here, just to make you a little more comfortable with the Denver market, and for all the people that are saying, hey, I'm going to sit on the sidelines and I'm going to wait for my opportunity. Right now, there's 90,000 homes in forbearance in Colorado. Mm. There's 1.658 million homes in Colorado as a total. 37% in Colorado are owned 100% free and clear.
37%.
So out of what's left, 90,000 homes, 80% of married people in Colorado own their home. Not free and clear, but are homeowners.
Right.
So there's a huge ownership state. But anyway, 90,000 homes right now are in forbearance. 25% have actually never missed a payment. They just went into forbearance for a just in case when COVID was happening, never missed a payment. 30% are modified and performing. It really comes down to currently there's about 4,500 homes that are possibly in trouble. And if all of those hit the market right now, today, it would bring us to 1.6 months of inventory, which is an extreme seller's market.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
So values aren't going anywhere here. And that's why I've been suggesting house hacking to a lot of people.
Feet on the ground, are you hearing, are you seeing about developers looking to answer to help modify that problem of the shortage of homes that are on the market?
There absolutely has been a response by developers. Most of that response, of course, is going into A-class in every direction. So the sticks you're seeing coming out of the ground for the single family type thing, very little of that's coming out of the ground for $750,000, $800,000, most of it well north of a million. This is one of the few places that we're having even a bidding war at houses above $1 million. The only thing that's stagnant here are condos above $1 million. That is the only thing that's in a buyer's market right now. So let's walk through some of the rents and kind of what you can expect when you get involved in part of the Denver market here. So for a single family home, we're seeing rents average around, I would say, $1 a square foot-ish. And then you really start to hit a wall after about $2,700 a month. And that's for really nice houses to mid-grade homes. We're really seeing a lot of the lower rents get bidded up, and then they hit really a wall right before you hit $3,000 until you hit that luxury market. So if you're going to buy out a house and rent it out, that's basically what you're looking at. But the same seems to be holding true for when you're doing a house hack, is about $1 a square foot with everything included. You can Airbnb, VRBO, temp rental, only your primary space. And they're very serious about that here. They will catch you. They put people in jail over buying a house and Airbnb-ing it out. So the key here is to kind of find your space. Our house is really perfectly set, really close to the highway, and we're about 10 minutes from downtown. You can pretty much walk to the Highlands downtown from our house, and we're about 30 minutes to hit the mountains. And if you can be in that strip, you know, as far as Airbnb is concerned, you can get a lot of money. But as long as you are, I would say, west of the Aurora line, you see a pretty good bid on Airbnb.
Given the price of the homes, not a lot of folks can afford the down payment on a home averaging $650,000. Has that been taken on any kind of movement, single family for rentals?
Not new build in Denver, but you do see some single family rentals here. And that, really, I have a couple of areas I can go over. About a 0.5% rule is what we're really seeing here. And so to break that down, nobody left behind. You know, if you're buying a house for $450,000, you can pretty well expect to rent that house out for $2,200 a month. That can be really tough on investors at some point. One of the things here is the bid is so high, we're not really seeing the build to rent model until you go fairly far up north. And so anybody that knows the Colorado area, you can go about an hour and 15 minutes north of Denver. And that's where you're starting to see more entry level type stuff. And you are seeing people that are doing a build to rent model up north that way. And then if you go south all the way down towards Pueblo, which is hours and hours from Denver, you know, you're starting to see that model there. Really, Denver is spilling out pretty heavy into all the surrounding areas. Mm-hmm. And we're seeing a really good bid up pretty much everywhere. There are some areas that you can still find some decent single families to rent. I also do think that there is still a really good opportunity for quads here.
Some of that spillover, and we hear that a lot about cities that are benefiting from migration of folks coming in from other large metro cities.
We do hold the title, the worst drivers, I think, in America. So good for us. Traffic is really, really tough. Our roads really are not keeping up with the growth. There's some giant plans to expand roadways, but most of that is focusing on our east to west because we have a bottleneck basically from our airport to the mountains. Where people are really getting bogged down is our north to south. And where a lot of that building is happening up north for that travel down into Denver, we've seen travel times quadruple. And what that is doing, I think, is helping keep some of that pricing down a little bit. And once that issue is solved, I think that you're going to see housing change drastically in that northern market. I would say that that's more than a decade out. So infrastructure-wise, there is a little bit of a struggle to keep up with some of the growth north and south of Denver. Right. But one of the things that we've seen is we've seen a huge investment in tech in Denver. And we have a Google hub here. We have an Amazon hub here. So we have seen a large spillover into the work from home or remote satellite offices. And that is really what has allowed the density from Highlands, Denver, that whole area to spill out into some of these other areas. And you're seeing homes that in what used to be not the best spot, middle of the field, middle of nowhere. The smart thing that the cities are doing in their planning is the first thing they're doing is putting in really wide, really nice roads. Second thing is they're putting in all of the shopping centers and that sort of thing, and then the housing and schools. And so we are seeing a lot of that stuff being overlaid, I would say, fairly properly to handle the density in those new areas where we're building out. And they're building some really nice product.
How have the banks reacted to the population growth, the income growth, appreciation in home values, and even rents and so on and so forth?
They don't seem to be overly skeptical, other than from my personal experience. If you're self-employed, there's been a lot of lending standards that have been extremely tightened up. It is hard to get a full bead on how that looks because, you know, we just sold a rental not too long ago in Denver. And really, everybody's seeing the same thing that, you know, in a weekend, you'll probably have 45 offers. You'll have a bunch of them cash offers, waived appraisal, escalations, all that sort of thing. It's a fierce, fierce bidding war. That house that we sold, we put maybe about $4,000 into it. And it ended up going for over 10% over asking. It was on the market less than a day. A person that bought it for $450,000, they put $300,000 down on the house.
Wow.
It's kind of hard to get a pulse on that. You know, we are still seeing some conventional buying going on here. And, you know, I have some other friends that have bought some houses and stuff out here. It's just normal bread and butter, what you're going to buy, condos, that sort of thing as well. And I haven't seen any major tightening. In fact, banks are typically fairly happy to waive appraisals and that sort of thing because they've seen the trend in Denver.
You know, if an investor wants to get started investing in Denver today, whether they're based in Denver or they're coming from outside Denver, I'm sure you guys have been seeing a lot of folks coming from other states investing, you know, in Denver. How would you recommend that they get started?
I absolutely would recommend house hack strategy. If you're coming from out of the state, you really need to find a real estate agent that is very, very sharp, has been here a while, is on their game, or you also really need to put boots on the ground. There's a lot of product that's getting put online. Pictures look really nice. There's people that out of state are just buying sight unseen, and they are absolutely picking some of the worst neighborhoods. They'll build, you know, an $800,000 flip out there, and you end up moving out there, and before you know it, spray paint on the side of your house and whatnot. Right. I mean, there's a big game going on with that right now. You really need to be boots on the ground. Denver, Colorado in general is a really, really unique market that you just generally see million-dollar homes right next to manufactured housing, that sort of thing. And take your time, pick your neighborhoods, and then figure out which neighborhood you want to buy in, and then be a little bit patient and buy in one of those neighborhoods. A few areas that I see being really good spots to buy. There's an area just north of Denver called Globeville. And if you come to the southern part of that area, I think it's one of the most undervalued places in Denver. There's still a lot of warehousing and stuff that's up in Globeville, but you are seeing some pretty good pricing on housing up there. Okay. You know, you're going to have to put some elbow grease into it. It's an older part of town. You're probably going to buy a house that's 100 years old, but it's not a historic district. So that saves quite a bit of money on that end. And you enjoy a lot of stuff. A lot of those houses have views of downtown Denver and about less than 2 miles to get to the ball fields and all that stuff downtown. The River North district is just south of Globeville. You're getting a little bit closer to Denver. It puts you right on top of the art district, right on top of the ball fields, right on top of the downtown life. And the key to this area is you can still find a lot of single family homes. Mm-hmm. And to me, if you don't own the dirt, you know, I'm not huge in investing in a bunch of the condos, stuff like that. You don't have control over HOAs, that sort of thing. Right. But this is an area where you can still buy good dirt, decent sized lots, nice single family homes. And if you house hack and do it right, you know, you're going to see huge appreciation and really good rents, Airbnb, all that sort of thing. It's really hot in that area. I just have a couple more areas. The Cole neighborhood, this is a historic district of Denver. So you do need to be a little bit careful here and make sure that you add that into your rehab and CapEx budgets. You know, if you're going to replace a window, you have to replace it with, you know, wood framed, all that kind of stuff. You know, everything. Right. They're very, very particular on that. Rosedale neighborhood. This is an area I've helped quite a few friends buy some places. And this is over by Porter Hospital. There is a really large park there. And this is also a really good area if you can survive that about 0.5% rule. It's a really great area to buy some rentals. It'll always be full being next to a hospital. You're also next to DU up there. And that's an area that has been seeing about 12% a year in appreciation. And then our last area that we were in was the Ruby Hill Athmar area. Mm-hmm. There's a giant amphitheater they just built there. There's two giant parks, a giant lake there. This is an area that, once again, if you're going to go into that area, you need to make sure you have boots on the ground. Do not fly it by over there blind, because one street is quiet, beautiful, wonderful. The next street is very much not. And so you really need to know what you're doing when you get down in those areas.
Great summary and everything else like that. One thing I always leave with our guest speakers, Kevin, what can we, our listeners, do to help you guys achieve your goals for this year?
First of all, I'd like to say, you know, for any of you guys listening out there, if you need help finding somebody out here, real estate agent, anything like that, please reach out to me at kevin@planforlife.com. You know, I'd love to meet anybody. I love having coffee and whiskey with anybody that wants to chat about real estate. You know, outside of that, if anybody's looking for it, I do run that Plan for Life company. We work with people, counseling them on how to do a house hack, how to build their network, how to start businesses, run businesses, that sort of thing. And then the final thing is, you know, if you're a real estate agent out here, a business broker, my wife owns a company called The Agent Asset. If you look that up, it's a VA company that works directly with real estate agents, business brokers, and light businesses. And we handle everything. We make it so that they can, you know, just focus on their highest, best use. And so if that fits you, go ahead and reach out to us. Other than that, I appreciate any conversation with anybody.
I appreciate it. Folks, you heard Kevin. Plan for Life on him. Agent Asset for his wife. Please check them out. These folks not only helping themselves, but more importantly, in my opinion, helping other folks achieving their dreams, like you said, from being renters from a house hacking position all the way to growing to becoming an accredited investor so they can participate in those syndicated offerings. Kevin, I can't thank you enough, man. Thanks so much for spending the time with us today. To everyone, please stay safe, happy hunting, and have a great, healthy, profitable week. Kevin, take care.
Thanks. God bless.